this is our St. Patrick's Day program. We're going to get you in the mood for St. Patrick's Day by hearing and discussing Irish bagpipes. Please stay tuned.
Welcome to The Better Part, a program that encompasses a diverse spectrum of topics important to our community, which we hope will both inform and entertain you. We invite you to sit back and enjoy the program.
Hello, I'm Phil Lenihan for The Better Part. Our guest today is Richard Katz. Richard Katz is a professional Celtic musician. He plays the Highland pipes, the Irish pipes, the baron, and the penny whistle. He has also appeared numerous times with the Chieftains, a very, very popular Irish group, and they come visiting on the West Coast. Welcome, Richard. Welcome to the show.
Thank you, Phil. Thanks for having me. I look forward to performing some traditional Irish music for you today.
So this should be fun. What is the category of musical instruments that encompasses bagpipes?
Well, bagpipes are in the woodwind category of musical instruments, and there are many, many different types of bagpipes around the world. There are the Irish, which I'm playing today, called the Ellen pipes, which means elbow in Gaelic, Scottish Highland pipes, which most people are familiar with, and then lots of other countries, Italy, Bulgaria, they all have different types of bagpipes.
Most people are surprised that there are bagpipes not exclusively in Scotland.
Right. It's always a surprise for them to see these bagpipes because they're not familiar with these at all and they've not seen them before.
The most hilarious looking bagpipes that I've seen are Bulgarian bagpipes. And they have like a 4-foot drone that goes down in front.
Right, huge drones, and usually the body of a goat used as the bag. It's quite interesting, and they're very, very large.
I did see a clip on the internet the other day with a goat skin, mm-hmm. with the head,
yeah.
or as the bag, as set up for bagpipes.
Right, right.
So when did you start playing bagpipes?
I actually grew up being a drummer, played rock and roll music as a youth, and then a little later in life, my wife and I went to a Scottish dinner. There was a pipe major there at the time looking for students to teach. My wife prodded me and said, "You'd like to do that?" And I said, "Okay." So I started taking lessons, took lessons from him. Then I proceeded to take lessons with a student of his, then on to a professional piper who taught the student and myself. And we went into competition and did competing for about 5 years.
Were those on Irish pipes or on Highland pipes?
Those are on the Scottish Highland pipes.
Okay. So when did you venture over to the Irish pipes?
Well, about the late 90s, about 97-ish, River Dance came out in the United States on PBS. I was one of the many thousands of people that saw River Dance on television first, and I saw a gentleman named Davy Spillane from Ireland playing the Ellen pipes. And I was convinced at that point that I needed to get a set made for me.
Well, Irish music was really inspired by Riverdance, wasn't it? A great resurgence in Irish music, wasn't it?
In the United States particularly, people were reawakened to Irish music. It had been around, but not quite popular here. When Riverdance came out and then followed by Lord of the Dance, Michael Flatley's program, it just took off like crazy in this country, and especially the Ellen pipes became very popular amongst musicians generally, and a lot of Highland pipers like myself became interested and came over to that side, started learning.
You use the phrase Ellen pipes. Is that the official name of your Irish pipes?
Yeah, it's pronounced Ellen. It's spelled U-I-L-L-E-A-N-N. So a lot of people think it's Julian, mm-hmm. and I've even heard it pronounced alien, which is hilarious.
Some people would consider it alien.
Yeah, and they do. And again, it's an Irish Gaelic word that means elbow, mm-hmm. because you pump a bellows with one elbow and you squeeze the bag with the other.
Let me backtrack for a minute. Explain to our viewers who hasn't been exposed to it, what was Riverdance?
Riverdance was a program promoting Irish music that used traditional Irish music and a lot of new written material, obviously, and also a lot of Irish dancing. And it took off in the late 90s and became very popular. It's been running ever since. And I actually saw it in person at Flint Center at De Anza College years ago.
So did I.
Yeah, good. You might have been there the same night.
I don't know how many nights they played.
I don't either.
But I have the DVDs, and it's still a thrill to watch, and the music is so great.
It's amazing, yeah.
Okay, well, I think now it's time to hear the Ilian bagpipes.
All right, thank you. The first tune I'm going to play is called The March of the King of Leash. Leash is a county in Ireland, and it's pronounced Leash, even though it doesn't look that way.
How is it spelled?
L-A-O-I-S-E, not louse, Leash. And this is a very old tune written by Rory Moore. It's sort of a rebellion tune, and it was written, I believe, in the 16th century. So I'll pump these up and play you a tune. Thank you.
I'm watching all those notes that you're playing, and that's a lot of playing. Can you give us a little explanation of the various parts of the bagpipe? And unlike the Highland pipes, you have drones lying on your lap.
Mm-hmm.
How many? Five?
There are three drones.
Three drones.
So
why don't you just start explaining?
Just explain.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, first of all, this piece is called the chanter. Chanter is a very old Latin word that means to sing. This is the part that sings. This is very similar to an oboe with a double reed inside the cap. Mm-hmm. There is a bag. It is made of cowhide and stitched underneath my nice little carpeting mm-hmm. here. This is called the main stock. And in the main stock are the three drones. You can see on the other side how long they are. There is a bass drone, baritone drone, and a tenor drone. These three items are the bass, baritone, and tenor regulator. The regulators are the same as a chanter with a double reed, but they have keys, so you can play them with your hand like a little pipe organ.
Could you give us just a little explanation
yes.
of the register?
Okay. So while you're playing a tune, and then the idea is, with the pipes up here, you're playing and you're playing like that. And I'm just really still practicing those. And the other nice thing about these pipes compared to Highland pipes is you can turn the drones on and off. So if you start, say, a slow air, I can turn them on and off with my wrist.
That is nice.
Which is a really nice feature.
The only way I can turn the Highland pipes off is with rubber plugs.
Well, I always tell people when I'm playing the Highland pipes, first of all, they'll come up and want to talk to you, so you just have to stop.
Right.
And I always tell them it's a constant sound. To stop them is to stop playing for the drones.
It's interesting. If our viewers have heard an odd sound, the bellows does make a little sound in the background as we're talking.
And it does.
That's not a fault of our audio system.
There is a valve that makes a nice little grunting
sound. Grunting noise.
If I push on the bag wrong.
Yes.
So I
apologize
for that.
Can I get these on Amazon?
No, not really. No. You can buy them over the internet. Mm-hmm. However, I would say that any instrument you purchase, especially in the bagpipe world, make sure you talk to somebody reputable that makes them, or somebody who's a professional that can guide you directly to a maker. These were custom made for me in Glencar, Sligo, Ireland by a fellow named Charles Roberts. They were made to my specifications and he did some custom work on these that I asked for. It took about a year to make them. And then I added the regulator parts about a year later. That took another year to make these parts. Then the scary thing is I had to send the whole thing back to Ireland for him to fit these, and it took a couple months for him to send them back.
So when you first got them, they were simpler setup?
Yeah, Ellen pipes come in three configurations. The first is called a practice set. It's the bag, the bellows, and the chanter.
Uh-huh.
Nothing here.
Okay.
The second setup is called a half set. The half set is the bag, bellows, chanter, and the three drones in the stock. Mm-hmm. This is called a full set. Mm-hmm. A full set comprises of everything I spoke of, plus the regulators. This instrument is pitched in the key of D, concert D. Mm-hmm. So I have and can play with symphony orchestras or other musicians. They do come in different keys. They come in D primarily, but they come in C sharp, C, and B.
Why would you choose a different key?
You would choose a different key to play with different instruments. However, those sets are termed flat set. And flat sets, people that play those primarily play those as solo instruments. They're not easy to play against because of the keys. The D set was developed actually by the Taylor brothers in the United States in the 1800s to help them play on vaudeville stages. They're louder than flat sets, and they're pitched to play with other instruments.
Okay. Tell us about your adventures with the Chieftains.
Well, the Chieftains. My first encounter with the Chieftains was a concert my wife and I attended at Davies Symphony Hall in San Francisco in 2001. My dream was to meet them. So we were actually eating at a restaurant in a front window and saw Matt Malloy walk by, the flute player. My wife said, "Go catch him." So I ran out and I approached him and I think I frightened him, but I said who I was and that I played Ellen pipes and I was part of the society in Dublin. And he said, "I don't have a lot of time. I'm going to eat before the concert, but if you could come backstage at the half intermission, we'll have you on the list." I thought, oh, my dream. So we went backstage and met with them. And at that time, Patty Maloney and Matt came up to me and Patty said, "So Richard, you're going to play with us today." I said, "No, Patty, I have no intention of playing, nor did I bring my pipes." And he says, "Well, do you have anything?" And I said, "Well, I always carry a whistle." He says, "Well, you can come play with us on the stage." So we went over a few tunes, and sure enough, I went out and played three tunes in the finale with them at that time. Full house, it was terrifying. And then they came again in 2009, in February, again to Davies Symphony Hall. I made arrangements through their management to play with them again on the Ellen pipes, which was a thrill. You can see it on YouTube through my website. And then again, I just played with them at the Mountain Winery this October 5th in the finale again on Ellen pipes. A great honor to play with these fellows. This is their 50th anniversary tour this year.
I can't imagine that they stayed together so long.
It's amazing that they're still running around the globe. After the tour they did on the West Coast, they headed to Japan. So they're in Japan right now.
So you played for the finale. Is that where they dance all around? Everybody's dancing around?
Yeah, the finale, they do what's called a round robin. They play a song, and then they stop, and everybody gets a solo. So I get my solo, and I finish my solo, and we go back into the tune. And then that's when they bring out all the dancers and the Highland Pipers, and it's the big thing for the finale of the program.
And the audience dances, too.
And they get up and dance in the aisles, and sometimes they come up on stage.
Doing that holding and dancing looks like Russian dancing.
Yeah, it's like a Kaylee. It's a big party.
Okay, I think it's time for another tune.
Okay. The tune I'm going to play now is a tune I actually learned from the playing of Leo Rousham, who was a famous piper in Ireland, probably one of the primary people that got Island piping back popular in the 70s. This song is called The Old Man Rocking the Cradle, and I primarily learned it to play for my new granddaughter.
Oh.
So this is how it goes. This is a slow air, by the way. It's a lullaby.
How did your granddaughter like it?
Well, I don't know how she likes it because she's only 8 months old.
Oh.
But my wife says it's her favorite tune now. And the interesting part about that tune, the story is it was written as a lullaby. The first part of the tune is the old man singing the lullaby. The second part where it picks up is the old man rocking the cradle.
Oh, very nice. Yeah. There is a tune called Rocking the Cradle, isn't there?
There is.
Yeah. It's a jig?
Yeah.
Yeah, Rocking the Cradle. Just briefly review some of the other instruments that you play.
Well, I play the Scottish Highland Pipes. Mm-hmm. I play the Irish Tin Whistle. Only one of them is tin. Mostly they're brass or made out of African blackwood. I play the baran. That is my baran behind us. And just for your education, the word baran in Irish means deaf or dull sounding. That drum was actually made for me in the Orkney Islands of Scotland, custom made. And then the Irish Island Pipes are the Celtic instruments that I perform on.
I don't know whether it's true, but I heard a story about the baran, is that in the winter, they used to have their windows covered with a skin in the cottages.
Yeah.
And when they took them out in the summer, they use them as drums. Is there any truth to that?
That's news to me. I wouldn't doubt it, though.
Well, not heard that little, one. The always little fairy tales.
Yes.
Oh, do you also teach?
I do teach out of my home. I have taught several Ellen Pipe students, several Highland Pipers. I have one student right now taking whistle lessons from me. And a real short story, one of my very good pipe students who was from New Zealand took lessons from me for about 2 years, and then I convinced him to compete. He eventually competed against me and took first, and I took second. He came up to me and apologized, and I said, Ian, don't apologize. That's proof of good teaching.
Okay, that's good.
So I was thrilled that he beat me.
Okay.
Yeah.
The tin whistle, we still call it, is it's such a simple instrument. And they get so much music out of it.
It's phenomenal. I mean, you can buy one for $10 still.
Right.
Cheapest instrument I know of. It has six holes and unlimited amount of music to be played on it. And it's so emotional and beautiful to play.
I saw somebody play in San Francisco. They had an Irish festival on the pier, one of the piers, Fort Mason.
Oh, yeah.
And she took off on the penny whistle.
Yeah.
And I couldn't believe it. I mean, she is ripping.
Yeah, and most people that play the Ellen Pipe start on the penny whistle. And almost all of the music on the penny whistle, you can play it on the pipes. A lot of the tunes I play on the pipes actually learn on the whistle first and then convert over. The fingering is a little different, but it's close enough.
They did. I don't know how successful it was. They did make a penny whistle with Highland piping, chanter, fingering.
Oh, wow.
But the style is different, so it doesn't lend itself to the same fingering. You can play the notes, but you just don't get the same sound.
Yeah, the Highland piping technique and gracing and the movements are different than Ellen piping. There are a lot of similarities, but their movements, some of them are a lot more complex. It's much more military. The Ellen pipes, Irish music's a lot more free. When I learn a tune, I learn it and then I do variations. I play it how I'm feeling that day.
Like a jazz musician.
Yeah. And when I play with other Ellen Pipers, we may play the same tune, totally different setting, works together, but they're playing it differently than I am with their variations.
Now, you play around the Bay Area in what's called sessions. First, explain what sessions are, and then where are they?
A session is a gathering of musicians, usually at a pub of some sort. You may know the other musicians, you may not, and you basically call out a tune or start playing. The people that know the tune join in. It's very free form, and I played at sessions for 15 years at least. The primary sessions I know about are over at C.B. Hannigan's in Los Gatos, and also down at O'Flaherty's on San Pedro Square in San Jose have pretty vibrant sessions going on locally.
How do you sit down and play with a bunch of musicians and you have a choice of hundreds of tunes? Is there a standard set? You have 25 or something?
Well, there are session standards that you can be assured if you play, most everybody knows. They're standard melodies that most people have learned. I used to have fun when people came to my session that I ran. They say, well, what if I don't know the tunes you're playing? I said, then you get a solo. or we may not know the tune you're playing. And that's kind of how it works. I may start a tune in and everybody's just listening. And then somebody who's a little more accomplished may pick it up and start joining in or play variations around what I'm doing. And it all works. It's fun and it's meant to be fun.
Okay. Now you belong to a local organization called, what is it called? The San Francisco Irish Pipers Association?
Yeah, I belong to the San Francisco Pipers Club.
Pipers Club.
We're based out of San Francisco, but we're all over the Bay Area. They usually have general meetings, used to have general meetings once a month where we got together and talked business and then played music together. But again, the main focus of the Pipers Club is what's called the Chenal, the gathering. Ours will take place up in Berkeley in mid-February over the President's Day weekend all the time. And we switch off with the Seattle Pipers Club. We do ours every other year and theirs every other year. So you have to travel if you want to go every year.
Well, we'll have to apologize to our viewers because this program will be on after the dates that you have mentioned.
Yes, it will.
But that's fine. They can look for it for next year or they can contact you. There'll be contact information at the end of the show. So, Richard, thank you for coming with us. Thank you for sharing your music.
You're welcome.
And would you like to play us out?
Yes. I'm going to play a tune now that is actually a Scottish tune. You can play a variety of tunes on Ellen Pipes, not just Irish. This is called The Wild Rose of the Mountain. It's a song, and this was a favorite of my late mother's.
Okay. Thank you for joining us for our St. Patrick's Day show. And if you're out celebrating, please have a responsible St. Patrick's Day and have a glorious time. We'll see you next week on The Better Part.